us how you counted 13. How'd you count?
I counted 10, then 3 equals 13.
Okay, so how did you know there was 10 right here?
Because I counted before.
Did you say 1, 2, 3 like that?
No, I said 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
Okay. And then you knew that 10 and 3 more made how many?
13.
13. Cool. Did anybody count it a different way? Anybody count it a different way? What did you do?
Twos.
You counted by twos? Come show us.
We are inborn with a mathematical sense, a number sense. And that is something that very, very young kids come with. We can build on that conceptually right from the beginning. One of the things that people often ask me when I'm asked about the Common Core standards for young children is, mathematics, isn't that very abstract? Why are we pushing it down on kids? And it just doesn't feel developmentally appropriate for kids to be doing all this math in early years. But it's a misunderstanding, largely, on what the nature of mathematics. Mathematics is abstract. It's an abstraction. But children, from very early age, show signs of being able to work with mathematics and work with mathematical abstractions. As soon as a kid can say two doggies and two chairs and recognize and use that term to describe the quantity in both those very different situations, they're making an abstraction.
You went 4 + 6 = 10.
Second graders, 7-year-olds are very concrete people. They like to touch things and draw pictures of things and hold things and really think about the world in very concrete ways. So I try and move them from a very concrete situation, using actual objects sometimes, to a picture, to just numbers. And I think having some context to sort of hang the numbers on helps them do that.
The Common Core standards, I believe, are very developmentally appropriate because they build on foundational skills that students need to know.
So I might say 10, 11, 12, 13.
And when we start at that foundational level, we're really looking at the age where a student is, say in grade 1, they're working on repeated addition. And they might be looking at it in very, very simple terms, such as there's 5 people, how many fingers do they have? And that's something where a first grader might draw a picture, and that's very appropriate for a first grader. Some first graders might even be writing an equation where they're writing 10 plus 10 plus 10 plus 10 plus 10. Other students might just be skip counting and say 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. And so all of those ways are appropriate at the first grade level.
Interestingly, the Common Core state standards, when we first wrote that, we didn't start writing standards. We wrote learning paths or learning trajectories. We wrote stories of how kids think and learn about these things up through the grades. And we knew that the research behind those learning paths was developmentally appropriate. From the earliest years, we have massive research that these ideas are ideas that kids can not only handle or learn, but enjoy learning and like to think about.
Why do you think I'm missing 2 markers?
It's important that students understand the place values and how the base 10 number system works. So one way we like to do that is have them focus a lot on the number 10 in first grade. How we get to the number 10, different ways, strategy, adding, subtracting, all around the number 10.
One of the things that is emphasized in the Common Core standards is an idea of story problems that aren't traditional. You know, it might not be that Juan has 42 marbles and loses 17 of them. How many does he have left? It might be that Juan has 42 marbles and loses some of them. Now he has 17 left. How many did he lose? And this is where I think it's really important for kids to kind of, what I say to my own kids at school is to make a movie in your mind. What's happening in this story?
We read a story problem. We have to visualize. We're starting to think about what I'm going to have to do with the story problem. Now it comes to solving a story problem. We've talked about over the last couple weeks all the different strategies we can use and the tools we can use. What are some of the things we've been using in second grade to help us solve a story problem?
Number line.
A number line's one of the tools we use. Okay, so let's write that down, because this will help us when we do our problems. So we use number lines.
There are different problem types. We're used to the typical problem types. We're used to 4 apples plus 6 apples equals how many? Or maybe 10 apples, you gave 6 to a friend, how many are left? Okay, but there's many other problem types you can have. You can ask this, with the same numbers, you could ask, you had 10 apples, and then you ate some, and now you have 6 left. How many did you eat? Oh, okay, so now I have to think about, I'm missing that part of the problem, the amount I ate, the trick. It's not after the equal sign that I'm just going to say. The situation would be 10 minus something equals 6. And then here's a mind blower for kids especially. You had some apples, and then you ate 4. And now you've still got 6 left. How many did you start with? Whoa, now you have to think back to the start, or you have to think very carefully. So if I ate 4 and there's still 6 in front of me, 6 is a part of the whole. 4 is a part of the whole. I just need to find the whole. I'll just add those together. So the adding is easy. The interpreting the situation is what's challenging about that. And kids that can answer all those different problem types are much more powerful thinkers than kids who haven't been challenged to think about how to apply mathematics in many different situations like that.
So if we look historically at the elementary mathematics curriculum, we can say that the arithmetic slice of that has been around forever. Adding, subtracting, multiplying, dividing numbers, it doesn't matter the age of those parents or grandparents who walk into the classroom for the meet the teacher day and talk about the math curriculum day. Everybody has done that. But what they probably haven't had the opportunity to do is link those operations together to realize that, you know, addition and subtraction are really connected operations, and that subtraction undoes what we did with addition when we combined things primarily.
Encouraging young children to find multiple ways to represent or solve a problem is really important, because we look at the real world problems that they encounter, and we need to build that stamina. We need to build that perseverance. Which strategy do you want to use to organize them?
I can't tell you how many times I've had parents come to me and say, oh, I was not good at math myself, so it's no surprise that, you know, so-and-so is struggling. I'm doing conferences actually this week at school, and I've heard that a lot. No parent would say to a child, oh, I really hate to read. We expect all kids to be reading people, and we would never send a message to our kids, our own children or our students, that that's acceptable. And I think we need to sort of think the same way about math.
I think one thing that's important for parents to understand is we're really trying to get students to show their work and show their thinking. By showing their work, showing their thinking, we can get a better idea of what they understand and what they don't understand. And that way, we can help them to really grasp a concept and move forward.
So, just being looking at the problem, maybe talking to your kid about the problem, using simple prompts. You can always step back and say, so, have you seen anything else like this? Have you guys solved a problem like this? What do you think this problem is saying? What have you tried so far? How could we maybe think of some other way of thinking about the problem? Those kind of general prompts and somebody just sitting there talking about it very often will lead that kid to say, oh, you know what I'm gonna try? And off they go.
I know, especially with my daughter, oftentimes she may think, well, this is math, you know, math homework, I'm done with it. I don't wanna talk about it once the homework's done. But I know for me, it's really important, say if we're going grocery shopping, that if she wants a certain number of apples or whatever she wants, that as a parent, it would normally be my reflex to just figure out for myself how much it costs, but I really try to include her in the conversation.
When parents have a question about a homework assignment, the first thing I would say they ought to do is go talk to the child's teacher. I mean, I think most of us in this profession love when parents come to us with a question about the curriculum. I think it gives us an opportunity to share with those families what we're doing, why we're doing it, and talk a little bit about how their kids' learning is happening.
In kindergarten, in first grade, in second grade, We want kids to be exploring mathematics and thinking about mathematics. How do you know? We always ask them, how do you know? You know, how did you figure that out? And the research shows that the more they talk about mathematics, they get better at reading and literacy skills as well as the mathematical skills. It's a powerful approach.
Not only am I a principal, but I'm also a parent. And really, first and foremost, I'm a parent. I have twin six-year-olds. I see my students flourishing, my children flourishing. And when they come home, especially in the area of math, when we start having discussions around the dinner table about what they worked on in class, or we sit down and look at a test and we're looking at what they completed, their ability to explain to me, even at 6 years old, what they did is incredible. And it's like heartwarming for me as a dad. Like, I almost tear up. I'm kind of like tearing up a little bit right now because I'm so excited about what their potential is and what I'm seeing from them so early on. It's just amazing.
And as a first grade teacher, the things I see happening in my classroom, the number sense my students have developed is so far beyond where our kids were just a few years ago. They're just heads and tails ahead of where they were because they have a true solid foundation.